The community comments, we ask people to limit it to 2 minutes, and so if you have a community comment, please stand and raise your hand and... Okay, yeah.
I'm president of Acton Women's Club, my name's Joyce Betts, and I understand that the town council is wanting the club to moderate the school board candidate forum. And so I'm here to represent the club to say that yes, we would be glad to partner with the town council to do that.
Oh, great, is there any days that would work better for you versus not?
Well, our meeting is Wednesday, so I'll have a better feel of who can do it, but...
Okay. Do you want us to reach out to the candidates, or do you want to reach out to the candidates, find out what days would work for them as well?
We can do that.
We can do it before.
We can do that, we can handle that.
The women's club, women's, okay, I don't know if there was... Oh, I'm sorry, I'm doing both.
It's weird. Yeah, no, women's club can do that.
Okay, perfect. Well, that sounds great, I know the town council is excited about it.
We'll just need people there to help and do all that.
I'm happy to do that.
Yeah, so we'll moderate and we'll, whatever, set it up.
Perfect.
At the community center or something, but we'll put it in the paper too.
Okay, thank you very much, Joyce.
So it's got to come up pretty quickly then.
We were talking about that last week in October, because it still gave people enough time to still look at the candidates again, you know, and you know, maybe talk to them and think through a little bit of their opinion, but not so far away that it won't keep them fresh in their mind. So we were talking about that last week, and we had something on Wednesday, so I had said Thursday.
I think you did, so...
Yeah, because...
Or Tuesday the 25th, whichever one, 25 or 27, was there something?
Something was happening on...
The 27th is the, well, I have a San Diego meeting.
On the 27th?
Oh, yeah, but that's...
But it'll be in the evening.
Forum on the 27th, I'm just going to put that down, or the 25th, which would be Tuesday.
Okay, so there's some flexibility in case one of the candidates can't make one night, so...
And we'll schedule it at the community club? Try to get the community club?
Yeah, I suppose we could do it here, it's available.
Oh, yeah.
I think we'll figure it out.
Is John in here?
Right there.
John, are either of those two nights available, the 25th or the 27th?
Can I go get my calendar real quick?
Yes, John, that would be lovely.
Let me grab it.
No, wing it off the top of your head.
Thank you, Joyce, I appreciate that. He's checking, I know there were other comments.
I'd like to thank the Women's Club for their cleanup efforts on the on-ramps, off-ramps. That trash was noticed by a lot of people that had said to me, have you seen all the garbage on the on-ramp? That's awesome that you guys did that.
Well, we just do Crown Valley, but...
Thank you.
And I don't get to participate in it because they typically do it on Saturday when I'm at work, but we do have some very dedicated members in our club.
Please tell them thank you from the community. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Great.
Hey, can I ask a question about that? Is there a general type of source of the trash that you noticed? Or is it from all sorts of places?
I would have to ask the people that have dumped the trash.
I'm curious about that.
You know, I do, I haven't adopted the, but Crown Valley was really bad, so.
Do you have those, you were those 2 days?
Excuse me, sorry.
Seven.
How long did it take before Kelly?
About an hour.
Yeah, it took about an hour because we'll make it very controlled. It won't be, you know, like, everybody just asking questions.
It should probably be soon as next year.
Okay, on October 25th, we have the Alzheimer's support group. They start from 7, they go till around 9. But we don't have anything before them, if you want to do a little bit earlier. On the 27th, we have the regular Toastmasters group coming in from about 6 to about 8 p.m.
So maybe it would be the community club.
Yeah, well, then
we'll the community center. Okay, I know a couple of folks come up. This is the time for public comment, so feel free to stand up and.
I live in Shannon. I just wanted to let the council know that in Shannon Valley, rather, on the party house, every Saturday night, apparently they're renting the place out, a large property, and, you know, allow, you know, different groups every Saturday, and we go till, frequently 1 o'clock in the morning. We've called the sheriff.
Sheriff.
Yeah.
Do the sheriff, the sheriff's pick up?
There is no law against having that kind of property in the county of Los Angeles as a tenant.
Having a property?
You can have a home and rent it out for parties, and it's, there's no law against it.
Are the parties disruptive?
Yes.
Yes, they're wild.
They can cite them, but who do you cite? Because there's no on-site owner. I've been working with county council, and we're going to try to go after it as a business because he advertises on the internet.
Okay.
And if we go after him as a business, then we have some teeth to go after.
So have you been coordinating, communicating to the residents in that area?
Some. I've been talking to Mike.
Okay.
I talked to, there's another gentleman who lives further up who has been complaining about the amount of traffic because they basically have valet car parking. They've got full bands, they've got a bar, they rent the place out. If you go to robertsranch.com, you'll see it listed right there, $1,526 a night to rent the facility.
Where do they park the cars?
In the back, on the...
on their lot?
On their lot.
It's a 20-acre property, according to the county recorder's site.
And it's zoned probably A2?
Correct.
It's zoned A2.
Well, so, I can hear them all the way up on... Shandale.
Yeah.
Do they have
the
okay?
Right,
okay, but in Acton, if you want to have a business, you have to go through, and Ruthie can talk, tell us all about it, the process of getting
through
the process of the county, get approval with your neighbors, and they all have to agree to it, or
exactly.
It doesn't happen.
But there's and the other site that, what's the name of the other site? There's a site that you can go on, for example, and there's probably 50 homes here that do it. They rent rooms for people for vacation.
Airbnb?
Yeah, Airbnb. And there's no law against that either. There's nothing on the county books, any, because it's not considered, it's a home business. It's not regulated. There's no zoning issue. You don't have to get a CUP. And he's listed on that site too.
But that's different from
a party
right.
For that.
Providing a party venue.
Right. But
which must have a CUP.
There's, yeah. However, there's nothing that prohibits you from renting your house out having a party right now. But because I've been all the way to county council, I've been downtown, and there's almost nothing that could be done right now. Except when I showed them the internet site, thanks to Mike, they were like, really, he's advertising? Oh, well, that makes it a business. If
yes.
He doesn't have a license, he doesn't have it, but county process is not an overnight process for that.
Right. And it's not just that he needs some sort of business license, but in Acton he would need to have approval for regional planning for that sort of
right.
Place.
And he has nothing.
Okay,
so there is nothing for this business. He apparently bought the house and decided I'm gonna rent it out. First started on that air site to rent rooms, and then he turned it into a party house.
Okay.
Yeah, I've been on the phone at least every other day with regional planning, county council.
Wow.
They planned one site visit for last week, and I guess it got canceled. We're hoping to do one this week, but there's like nobody there during the week.
Yeah, they need to go on a Friday night.
Well, who
at regional planning are you with?
Dan Gerringer.
Okay. And who at county council's office?
I'll have to get you her name. I don't have it. So
Lizzie
Gal?
Okay.
But... you know, unfortunately, those guys don't work at night.
Right.
No. And they
have
to get authorization
for
overtime from somebody, and that's probably not going to happen right away. But I gave them the list of all the calls that we've been to for noisy party. So they have a list of every night the deputies have been.
Well, but they don't need a site visit to proceed in this sort of regional planning CUP requirement because it's already
it doesn't happen overnight. They're
okay.
Not going to come out there and I've already gotten that. It was like, okay, we'll investigate it, we'll look into it, we'll work out.
Okay.
I got a cease and desist letter from the county saying that I could not be open until I completed the SUP.
Do you have a copy of that?
Yes, I do.
Can you shoot it to me, please? Someday. Thank you.
1999,
if they, and the CSD hasn't changed in that time.
No, and I, you know, to me, they should get a cease and desist letter. They shouldn't be able to rent the place out until they are fully in compliance, and they should also have to tell everybody that's renting that venue that they also have to comply with the quiet after 10 p.m. laws.
Right.
There's no law that says quiet after 10 p.m.
There is no law
that says you have to be quiet after 10 p.m. The law says you must not disturb a reasonable person's peace at any time. 10 in the morning, 7 in the morning, 3 in the afternoon, 4 at night, and 10 at night. That's
well,
the official, that's 415.3 of the penal code.
So
well,
how do you
but,
go
but
about
we have
making
the
party like get quieted down when you do? If you get a noise complaint,
right.
When you go to the noise complaint,
right.
What do you do?
You tell them, if we have to come back, you'll get cited. That's the way the code works.
And
have to get a warning, and they've already cited two of the venues that have been up there, but it's not the owner.
Right.
It's whoever the coordinator is gets the cite.
Right.
And what is the effect of the citation?
The citation is a misdemeanor. It's essentially, thanks to all the new codes, they get a, it looks like a traffic ticket that says show up in court.
And when they don't show up in court, is a bench warrant issue?
Nope. They send them another notice that says you've been scheduled for another hearing. You need to show up on this date.
And
if you don't show up by a second one, then it can go to warrant. But you won't get arrested unless the warrant goes over $25,000.
And what is this warrant valued at?
Probably about 10 grand.
Okay.
So what happens is, because the owner's there, we write a report behind it that goes to a detective. Now the detective does their best to get the person into court to show up.
But they might be in Germany, so.
But it's 60 days after the citation's written before they have to show up. And if they go plead no contest and pay the fine, because the owner of the property probably gives, here's the money, go, you know, then it's taken care of. The problem is locating the owner of record, because that's apparently what zoning's had the issue with.
How much is the fine when they pay it?
I don't know, it's up to a judge.
Okay.
That could be
so
anywhere between $100 and $10,000.
Okay, so if it isn't enough to make the
probably
party
not.
House rent not worth it.
Yeah, probably not.
Scott,
yeah.
County Council can't locate it through the title records, who's the owner?
That's what they're, well, I guess the owner is kind of
corporation.
It's corporation, and it's how do you find, you have to find somebody who's responsible. The guy who owns that site, Roberts Ranches, is the owner of record, at least by one of the profiles we picked
right.
up.
Did you come up with the address in, I think it was Hollywood, the house down there?
Yes, I got that. Everything got forwarded to county and to planning and county council, but this is what was found, you know, so hopefully, again, they haven't, last week, they were supposed to meet. I was going with them. Something came up, they got canceled. I'll check with Dan tomorrow.
So it's a corporation that owns it.
Right.
Probably not a for
probably
nonprofit.
Probably not LLC, I'm not sure.
Well, it doesn't matter. If it's a not a nonprofit, it's for a corporation that rents the house and it accrues revenue from the house.
Right.
It seems very clear that the business provisions of the code would apply.
Right.
So, and that is the
but
process.
But that's not something we take care
no,
of.
No, I understand.
Yeah.
So that's why I need to call to find out what's going, how quickly they're going to be moving on that, because
yeah.
they can move fast when they want to, just ask the NAT team. So.
Yeah, I know that they were, Dan Garinger was not happy with, but he didn't know about the place, they weren't happy with it at zoning. I know he did a drive-by, and again, nobody's there during the day.
Well, I'll talk to Dan, but would it be useful if the affected residents were to videotape?
Oh, that would be wonderful.
The events. From
anytime
various angles with lots of noise.
Well, because, yes, he is a, here, I can come up and
please,
it's easier
yeah.
to be yelling in the back.
And
I'll give you examples.
I think we can make it happen.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anything we can do to speed it up, let us know.
Yeah, I've written 3 tickets in town between Acton and Acton. I'll say, for example, noisy motorcycles, excessive noise dust. Because someone has to be the complaining party. Two of those, the people who insisted that they get cited, never showed up in court, so the judge goes, dismissed, thank you very much. The third one, guy shows up, complains, dust, I can't hear my TV. Judge says, okay, well, what proof do you have? Well, I'm telling you I can't hear the TV. Okay, do you make excessive noise with your motorcycles? Well, like, we go out there with the kids, we hose the field down before they ride, we hose it down in the middle, we hose it down when they're done, we take a rake across it. Well, that seems reasonable, dismissed.
But not at night.
Well.
Till 1 a.m. or whatever.
Yeah, I'm just telling you that you have to have proof.
Okay, sorry.
And basically, I tell people, if you're gonna get something like that, film it. And
so
we will take that, put it into the evidence file going, look, here's the complaint. And we're only getting, by the way, one or two people calling on this house. It's the same people all the time, but it's not everybody in the neighborhood. So it's hard to excite somebody downtown going, well, it's two people calling, we understand. We know it's business. We're gonna go after them for being a business, but, you know.
So would you recommend that the folks in that neighborhood, like,
call?
Not only that, but maybe work together.
Yes.
Provide the evidence and to call all the time.
Call all the time.
Call every 2 seconds.
Because all those calls get basically stored. And when we go to, like, there's a place, and I don't want to cast any aspersions, but it's a rental place in Agua Dulce, off of Agua Dulce Canyon by Davenport. Not going to say the name. Sorry. They're a commercial place that leases and rents. They have no operating permit. And we have been out there, I have personally cited the manager of the facility for a noise. Well, we get a call every Friday night that they've got something going on. And I forwarded all that to the county council because they're proceeding now with legal means to go after them for basically no permit, no CUP, they've just never renewed anything. But they still advertise. And it's like, well, okay, we'll go after them. I think you had a question, sir, back?
Yeah, some municipalities require an entertainment permit for people that are filming and doing things like that. Would that fit this?
No, okay. Filming permit is just for filming. We don't really have, if you're gonna get a permit for, like, Thousand Trails had an event, or having an event next week, okay, they have to get a temporary CUP, they have to apply if they're getting a liquor license, they have to go through ABC and get a liquor license, which they did. Then it comes to us for the traffic study, and we give them the permit for traffic study. Fire has to come out, and it's all on the same permit, basically, but it says, hey, they've got adequate first aid, they've got adequate restrooms, they've got adequate ingress and egress, and then they're issued a permit for the event.
But part of that is that party would come forward to you guys and see
right.
The process.
Yes, unless it was a permitted entity, which you won't have up there, but let's say you put in a banquet hall out here. Okay, that would be part of their CUP that they're allowed to have that, so it would just be normal business. But in a place like this, one, they're not gonna get it. And two, like I said, the county, you know, I sent them everything I had, so I'm trying to help the wheels go, but sometimes it takes a little bit. But yeah, any of your neighbors that wanna, tell them to call. Because I know I have that, I get calls sometimes on the weekend, going, hey, my neighbor had a noisy party on Smith or Gillespie. Well, it's 2 days later and there's no call to the station. I can't do anything 2 days later except tell them, hey, you know, your neighbors complain. Okay, great. Okay. So, and they did change the law that, and that's how we cite them a lot, is I can now be a victim as a police officer, sheriff's deputy, and if I drive by and hear the noise, I can go in and do something about it. That law changed like 2 years ago. Before that, we weren't allowed to complain. It had to be somebody in the neighborhood. So if I'm driving around and hear the noise, I go, oh, I can hear that 5 blocks over. That's excessive noise.
So you just do a warning?
We have to give a warning first.
And then you wait 2 minutes.
Then if we come back or, and there's other things we can do that has been done. If there's a live band, and I have done this once myself, I brought the band up and confiscated all their instruments as fruits of the crime, which means that goes into evidence. They don't get them back till the trial date.
Is there any reason why you couldn't implement something like that in this case?
Yeah, we could.
Okay.
But
if we get there before 2 a.m.
If we get there before 2 a.m. What I will do is if I'm going to try to elevate what if the town council would like to write a letter to our station captain saying, hey, we have this issue. And you could, you know, if you want to say I'm working it, or you could ignore me, whatever you want to do. You can say I spoke before you got about it, and you are requesting enforcement, the noise enforcement, that they don't come out 5 hours later, which is a couple of the calls we've had. Call comes out at 7 o'clock and they don't show up till 3, and by then it's over. Unfortunately, sometimes at night there is only one car between here and Leota Valley, so if they're on an emergency, this call will sit until they can get here.
So the letter would be, to the extent feasible, please expedite the investigation, and then don't leave the area for a little while until you're confirmed. That's stopped, okay.
And then that would help me, because then it's coming, then it's another voice saying, hey, we recognize there's a problem.
So if we get up some kind of petition and get, say, 10, 15 neighbors to sign it, would that help?
That would help, because we could bring that to the regional planning, you know, the people who do it, going, hey, here's further evidence that they're doing something they should.
Who's the station captain?
Dennis Neer, who, by the way, would like to come to a meeting sometime, so.
That'd be awesome. N-E-A-R.
K-N-E-E-R,
sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry. E-E-A-R?
K-N-E-E-R.
E-E-R.
Yeah. The K is silent. Pompeo Station, yeah. Yes, ma'am.
If regional planning is contacted about this house, they'll actually come out and sit and observe, and they'll watch during a weekend party, and they'll see what the complaint is about. And then what they'll do is they'll serve a cease and desist letter to the owner, and the owner will be told that if they don't immediately shut down their operation, that they'll be in violation, and that there'll be a fee imposed, a fine imposed, per day, for every day they're in non-compliance during the time they should be applying for their SUP.
So that would be a good idea, whenever you notice that, and each neighbor individually should do this multiple times if you need to in the night, write an email to, to Dan D. Geringer at planning.co.uk. It's on Lillian posted, and so does Acton. And also you would want to CC the director of regional planning. What's his name?
Bruckner.
Yeah, because they love when they start getting responses from citizens like that. That makes their job a whole lot easier.
It only took one call to have them come out to me.
So that'll help too.
One neighbor.
One neighbor called, and they came out and they sat all day long to count cars, because I was running a hair salon out of one of the rooms in my house in the rear of my home. And my neighbor didn't like the fact that I had a car coming and going every hour. So one neighbor calling justified regional planning coming out. So they will come out. You can call them directly.
Well, that's a good idea. Thanks, Ruthie. It's going to be 2 a.m., so the email.
The email work, because that goes in all the file. They keep all that stuff, the documentation.
Okay.
Jackie, do we want to do a letter?
Yeah, I think we should.
We need to make a motion on that.
Yeah, or you can't.
Is there anything else on this issue you want to talk about?
We don't have a quorum?
No.
Yeah, we do. We're only 7 people.
There were 2 more points I wanted to make on that.
We'll stand up so everyone can hear.
We got hundreds of cars driving in and out past Latino's house, and all seeing that your cars in your driveway, and neighbors have seen some of them driving around the neighborhood supposedly lost, whether there are or not, who knows.
Now, let me add to that. Last weekend, I believe it was, the neighbor at the top of my street, which is about 3/4 of a mile away from the place, had a car pull up into their driveway with an invitation for this wedding happening 1/2 mile that way that they couldn't find.
Yeah, it's very hard to find. The address isn't really clear on that property.
That's awesome.
We found it by noise.
Is there anything, Scott, with the signage? Because it's not reliable. Some of the parties, they put up signs, other ones they don't. Like the wedding, they had signs starting at Sierra Highway and running all the way up.
They're not allowed to put any signs. I mean, that's a violation of the zoning. Take pictures of that.
Pictures of the signs.
Pictures of the signs, because we'll turn it all into the, yeah.
Especially if the signs are still there 2 days later.
Yeah.
Because that's litter.
They don't take them down.
Oh, they do?
That's the other issue, is the fire hazard. One time they were shooting off rockets.
What?
July 9th, a little after 9 p.m., I called the Agua Dulce Fire Station, which covers our area, because the group in there partying that night was shooting fireworks.
If you can get that stuff on video.
Full airburst fireworks, not just rolling cannons.
And I don't know, fire does not cite, we do. We confiscate the fireworks and site. You're talking fines between $5,000 and $10,000.
Yeah.
Fireworks.
And if you had that sort of proof, that would be amazing. Yeah. You didn't video any of these? Or?
No, I didn't get that. Okay. I've got the call log, but that's it.
Okay. Well, don't lose those logs.
Yeah, don't lose.
Yeah. Fire showed up about 30 minutes after the call, because that was during the big fire in Santa Clarita, and Lancaster was covering Agua Dulce, and one of the neighbors had called the sheriff, and I don't know when they showed.
Yeah, I'll have to go look at it. That was July 4th?
July 9th.
Or July 9th.
This was the weekend following.
Okay, I'll go look that one up. They let me do that.
So is there any point in calling fire if you have
fireworks for the fire, but if you call, like, 911, then we respond with fire. Because sometimes fire doesn't call us. They go out and warn them and advise them. And it's like, hey, you know, you could get cited. We have been called by fire if they find enough proof. They'll call us on the radio, say, hey, have a deputy meet us out here because we got all these. They'll wait for us to show up. And then.
So the message is to call both.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other discussion on this? All right, I'll make a motion. I'll write it out.
Thank you.
To write a letter requesting the sheriff's department increase their what's the word I want to
response
expedite.
Time.
Response time. Expedite. That's right.
Expedite
response time to
noise enforcement.
Yes, to noise complaints. Within Acton.
Would you like a specific address?
It's on Via Femero.
No, it sounds like there are several of them. I'd rather not just focus on one.
Okay. Yeah.
And I also don't want to be perceived as only picking on one and not the other, so.
Yeah, there's several up here.
And ask them to stay in the area for a short while afterwards, just in case there's a repeat of the offense. So, that's my motion.
Do we have a second?
I second it.
Any discussion?
Motion passed.
Well, we have to vote on it.
Oh, all I just passed it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Passed.
Abstained?
There you go.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, while I'm up here,
Dennis,
real quick, if anybody wants to know what they're building at Santiago and Soledad, that is a RV or a truck storage lot. And that is permitted, because I called regional planning as soon as I saw them clear it off. They have all their permits because that is zoned industrial, I guess, there. And that is a permitted use for that piece of property.
Yes, but they're still required to have landscape plans and shielding.
It's already been in the works. They've never come before the town council. I know that.
Yeah.
But they have the right zoning.
Yeah, they had the right zoning because planning said, oh, they don't have to come before the town council. It's already permitted use.
Yeah. I will look that up.
Yeah. And we got a pizza parlor going in. Oh, for the old rustic cafe. It's going to be Pizza Palace. It's a relative of the one in Canyon Country. They're taking half the medical office and making another pizza parlor. It's amazing what you learn by driving around, talking to people.
Stopping noise.
The rustic cafe is gone?
It's been closed for
4 months.
Yeah.
I was bummed about that.
That was
too
bad. That was nice.
They did well. Yeah, she needed to spend time with her son, and it's hard to run a restaurant. He was a teenager, so I talked to her about it. But yeah, I saw them doing construction. They told me, oh yeah, they're moving this Yeah, it's not Pizza Place, it's Pizza Palace. It's a new, different.
Close enough.
So we'll have pizza there, pizza at Crazy's, pizza here, pizza at the market, and Big Mouth Pizza at Agua Dulce. We're good.
Pizza.
We could have all the parties we want.
Pizza parties.
Maybe that means the Rams are winning the Super Bowl. I don't know.
Okay, what do we got next, Jeff?
All right, any other public comments?
Anybody else?
Well, I thought you, did you want to make an announcement?
Oh, for the festival?
This would be the time if you
yeah.
wanted to.
Okay.
Or not, I mean, you don't have to.
Sure, but Pam, did you talk to the board about what we talked about too?
No.
Well, okay. Will you bring that up tonight or will you
yep.
bring that up Friday?
No, we'll bring it up.
Okay. What it is that we are doing a music festival here in Acton. It is at Thousand Trails. We are fully permitted. We have all of our paperwork in order, everything.
Music festival.
It's going to be from 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. It is a nonprofit organization. We do have our 501(c) that I have been badgered about constantly over and over and over about. It's to give back to ASMA, which is the music program here in the Acton Agua Dulce School District. We're also giving back to the Chamber. We're also giving back to the Middle Elementary School and to the Junior College, Junior College Music Program. I'm really excited. Our pre-sales are $10. We have 10 bands. There is going to be beer. We do have vendors. We're just really excited and we're hoping to bring music back to music and start making something new here in Acton just to help benefit different organizations, especially ones that involve the kids and whatnot. And
When is it Saturday?
Saturday.
Mm-hmm. Have you had pre-sale tickets?
Have you sold?
Give me an idea.
Right now we're under 100. But we also have our bands selling tickets too at their engagement, so I don't know what those numbers are. We do have 10 bands.
So you got a separate permit for this whole process?
Yes.
Okay.
We have a CUP. Yes.
Because the and that's
fire
great.
Safety.
No, that's great. The only reason concerned, the reason I ask, it has nothing to do with your effort or it sounds wonderful. But the CUP at Thousand Trails, their CUP doesn't allow the use of microphones and loudspeakers. So yours, I guess, has been separated from theirs?
Yes.
We have
okay.
It's a
CUP.
Right.
Okay.
It's all
right.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
So what?
It's
a
CUP.
Yeah.
CUP. I knew it wasn't a CUP.
Well, that's why I was like, wait a minute, I know what the CUP there says. That's not quite the same. So, okay. And all the neighbors around there know, because I got a call from a resident in that area down there in a bootlegger a week and a half ago, and apparently they had a big revival party there.
I've been attacked. He's basically said that we're going to have a rave and that we're going to sell drugs.
No. I'm talking about a neighbor complained 2 weeks ago.
Correct. It's the same gentleman, I'm sure.
Who?
And I spoke.
No, this is an event at Thousand Trails. It has nothing to do with your event.
That was a religious event he complained about, by the way.
Well, I'm with loudspeakers till after 11:30, so that's why I'm just.
No, we're 10 to 10.
No, and I appreciate that. I'm just separating. I need to understand how they're separated in space and in time, or in, at least in legal.
I have spoke to several of the residents over there, maybe not all of them. We're doing our best.
Okay, I appreciate that.
You know, unfortunately, I didn't come to you guys first, and we're really sorry about that. We were just trying to get in the process of everything, and we've never done this before, and this is all new to us, and we just want to be involved in the community, and our hearts were in the right place, but we didn't mean to overstep or not go to someone sooner, or we're just going and learning as we go.
Well, I didn't mean to imply any of that. I just want to understand the conditions under which you're operating.
I understand that. I'm just reaching
out. It sounds terrific, so.
And you'll sell tickets at the door, too,
yes,
right?
Yes, we will.
Good. I'll tell my neighbors.
John, did you get anything from Mr. Krosta?
Yeah,
Yes, yes, I was gonna add it to you as I report that.
Okay.
Do you like that?
Yeah, probably. It's got to do with this music festival.
I'm sorry, I didn't read it, I was just expecting.
Oh, and she contacted me about, so I'm gonna bring it up right now, about whether the town council would like to do a booth there. She's got vendors, so.
Rummage sale or?
I know, it's a busy.
Women's Club would love to participate, but we're doing a rummage sale.
You know, and I totally understand, and like I said, I feel bad coming so late in the game and saying this. I just know that there's so many important involvement that we need the community to be involved with, and if I had the time to run the booth myself and put up all the information, I would. There's just no possible way, because financially, we have to put in our actual time to be running around like crazy people, making sure that's right. So,
Okay, I'm reading this, I haven't seen this yet, so. I know, but I just got the phone call.
So he's actually referring to what my concerns are, because the CUP at that facility is very restricted. 1,000 trails. So he's right about that.
I'm gonna give everybody on the council time to read this letter that we received from Chris Croisdale.
Did Chris say that there's some, what is some action he would want? Is he, I don't see that. He's just, this looks like a notification of information he's obtained, which is useful.
Yes.
And important.
He wanted us to be aware.
Okay.
And said that he was dropping it off with John.
Okay.
So, I hadn't seen it before.
So this, yeah, because he's the one who called me, he said 2 weeks ago, it was horrendous. It was an event 2 weeks ago that was completely not allowed under their CUP. Mm-hmm. So, and it doesn't sound like that event 2 weeks ago pulled a TUP or a CUP or whatever the document
should. That's what I was just gonna ask, that they have a TUP, because if they didn't, it was illegal.
Well, this is the problem, and you need to understand with this particular venue, That is an ongoing problem. They had a Bible revival there, a tent revival, literally,
right.
Over 1,000 people there a couple of, some time ago, and never, for 2 days, and it just went on, and it was loud and really disruptive for the people in that area. So I sympathize with a lot of their concerns, and I appreciate how much you guys have, attempted to reach out to them, but what you're perhaps not aware of is that this particular venue has a history of being loud and using facilities that are not, they're specifically prohibited in their CUP condition. So, now you have the backstory, so you maybe understand a little bit more too. So, I'll call Oscar tomorrow, because I want to check on the status of this whole thing anyway.
Right.
I did send to Chris 2 weeks ago the conditions that they have on their CUP, which is being expired more than 10 years ago, but regional planning is still operating as if it's in full force and effect, which we'll leave that aside.
So what Chris is saying here is that the liquor license hasn't been issued yet?
Oh, well, how old is this,
ABC?
Though? Oh, well, that was 2 weeks ago. So I'll follow up with Oscar, because I want to talk to Oscar about the not your program, but the not your program at all, but the area. No, I don't have.
You do already have your liquor license.
We have everything.
We have everything.
Everything. Anything you need, we have it.
But this is also an ongoing concern with the venue itself and its own conditional use permit that's been issued and not really followed very well for a long time. So, okay, well, thank you very much.
Okay, so Jackie's going to follow up on this and report back to us. Is that?
I don't think there's anything to vote on.
No, there's nothing to vote on. This is information for us as the town council, and we appreciate you coming and telling us what your plans are, and we'll respond to Mr. Croisdale.
Well, I strongly suggest, though, that if you're going to stop at 10, that you do stop at 10.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, we are.
I know you will, but let me just reiterate that. So.
Also, we're setting up the stage and everything to face away from any of the residents.
So it's the back is pointing to the south and the noise is pointing towards the north?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All the sound is going to go within the park, pretty much. Unless it's banging off the gate.
Where is the stage?
The stage is in that back grass area close to Bootlegger. It's probably about...
So it's on the west end?
200 yards away from there.
Okay, so it's on the western end of it, mm-hmm. of the park.
And then that's the back of the stage is facing Bootlegger, and that faces this way, towards the pool.
Okay,
so Jackie?
I'll follow up with Osprey just to get a perspective on what they're thinking with respect to this venue
yeah.
and its uses going forward.
Right.
I mean, once a year thing, the event that you want to do, I've never heard a lot of complaints about it, but what's happening is this type of venue is being used, this venue's been used for this type of thing frequently. And
yes, that's what I was going to say, like the car show that's done there, they have their stage reversed, so the sound is literally pointing in the direction of
it. No, but my point is you're not supposed to have any of that stuff.
Plus, that's during the day.
No loudspeakers. No.
The car show, I think, is just during the day, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So, anyway, thank you very much.
A bigger time frame of music for 12 hours.
And it's not allowed there, according to CUP, period.
I know, Jackie.
So,
right, they will shake up their own.
Right, which is fine. But if there's a pattern of this 3-4 times a month, it becomes a business venue just like the party houses are. It's a gigantic, you know what I mean? It's okay.
Appreciate you coming, though.
Yeah. Are there any other public announcements? Okay.
We need to move on.
Yes, we do. All right, so. Minutes of the last meeting. I haven't read it yet. Can we vote on them next week?
We need to vote on them next time. I don't think there's enough. There's like three of us here that were.
Oh, okay.
That were here. So y'all read them. If anybody has any questions, that for the people that were here.
Thank you very much. You gave me and treasurer's report.
Treasurer's report.
Yep.
We've got 21,43.27 in our account.
21,43.27.
And our deposit was $400, and that was the fees that we collected for the election. No expenses.
Okay. Sheriff's report.
Oh. Unfortunately, have the stats because she wasn't in. That's right, the chairs and shirt.
Okay, good.
I can just let you know that looks like we had 29 from my count incidents that resulted in reports. And of those, and I don't have the exact number, but we did have some burglaries, a couple of drug arrests. So I'll have it by the next meeting. She should have it run off. We have a lot of the suspected child abuse and suspected elder calls that we have responded to because based on everything happening today, if somebody says, oh, I think something happened, either APS or DCSF will write a report to us saying, go out and investigate. And 99% of them are nothing. And we still have to go out and take a report so it gets logged as a report call.
But 1% of them aren't nothing.
And 1% of them turn into something or require further investigation.
It says 29 incidents for September?
Yeah. And I was trying to look here. We've had a couple of vehicle tows and a couple of drug arrests, like I said. And pretty much most of them were in that category of just looking quickly at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. About 14 were calls for APS or DCSF. So it goes up and down depending on what it is. We get a lot of calls of, you know, hey, I haven't seen my neighbor in 3 weeks. and they usually pick up their mail, and sometimes they're out of town, and sometimes they're, we find them. So, yes, ma'am?
The front cover of the Country Journal, Saturday.
Oh, the mail thefts.
Yeah, the mail thefts.
Right. We're having a series of mail thefts, a lot in the Shannon Valley area, Sierra Colony, Davenport, Escondido Canyon, Hubbard, on the Agua Dulce side. Pretty much those are where we're seeing a lot of them. We have them all the time. Most of the ones that we've had are the rural mailboxes that have no locks or anything on them. We have, it's been seen to be, it's either white, light gray, or cream, late model Jeep, two males in it, and they'll pull along the side of the road, pop the door open, one reaches their hand in, they take the mail and drive to the next one. Mm-hmm. Then they're seen down the street. Unfortunately, as I've said before, when you call me the day after and say, hey, this bothered me, and I saw it, if we don't have a license plate, I don't have a description, I can't do anything. And I tell you, if you see somebody stealing mail, call us immediately. Because we have guys, the guys that all work out here have all been told, if you get calls of following a big, go out there. And we're trying to find who these guys are. The post office, I talked to Gil, the manager at the Acton Post Office. We think the ones on Escondido and by Hubbard, that they have the key to the box, because we find it open. So then they just go through, they just pull everything out. We found sacks of mail where we've covered them in the market parking lot in Stallion Meadows. And it's all the circulars and the junk mail, if you will, for all these addresses. So they're going through taking what they want, and then they're just driving through a parking lot. They're just dumping the mail and taking off what they don't want and take off. So.
There are no cameras anywhere in these areas?
No. We've I've talked to several neighbors about putting them like Sierra Colony. They have cameras on order. If they're not up already, they might already be up. They were trying to get them this weekend.
But like Stallion Meadows, where they dump, they could get that on camera too.
I don't think they have a camera back.
Oh, it's in the back?
In the back.
Not near the community
room? Not near the community room at all. They're going up the backside and then dumping it in the parking lot. So we're actively looking for these guys.
Do you think they're after like credit card applications?
A lot of them.
Personal info, or what do you think they're after?
They're after money. We've had a couple of them. We've had a lead on a few where they've taken checks. And one of them is a couple of well-known gangsters out of Palmdale, has cashed some check. They signed their name, right, endorsed their name right on the back of a check, and the banks will cash them.
But you pick them up, right?
And we have to find them, because one of them's a parolee at large, so we know where his house was. But all the troops got a, what they call a bolo, be on the lookout with his picture going, if you see this guy, get him. But we know he frequents Palmdale's area. He's got homies out there. But it's hard. But yeah, these guys, they'll sign their name right to the check and cash it. And, you know, I can't say anything, but I would think if you're a bank, you would ask for ID. And if the name doesn't match, but you take a check in and go, hi, I'm so-and-so. Sign it. Okay. Cash the check.
Sounds like they have a friend at the bank.
They're not forging. It doesn't appear they're forging anything.
No, are they going to the bank of origin?
Yeah. Well, or a bank, you know, it'd be like Chase or Wells Fargo or what. They're going to a branch where the account is at one of their other branches.
Yeah.
So they verify, yeah, there's money in it. Thank you very much.
I've never heard of that.
But see, if you have, you know, and it's like, okay, how are they doing that? It's either they have an ATM card and they're going through the teller, because, you know, they don't check pictures. You can just deposit a check and get money out. And it's very easy to do. And then you catch it, you know, a couple of days later when you go through it. And then if you ask for the check back, then they just have a picture of it and not much anything else. So we're fighting it.
I got a question. A couple times in our neighborhood, there's only 5 houses on our street, but I've gone out on the street when all the doors on the mailboxes have been opened and just left open.
Right.
Do you want to know about something like that?
That would be helpful, yeah.
I mean, we don't have cameras or anything, and nobody saw anything, and I don't know if anything was taken.
Yeah, because, and, you know, we take a mail theft report, which we share with the postal inspectors, because they prefer we take it. But at least it gives us a plan of going, okay, where are these guys hitting next? Because we're getting hits and misses. I've had somebody say, hey, I saw a car, I saw these two guys, did you get a license plate? Oh no, I just wanted to get home to a phone. Okay, that's great, but we still don't have any info. I need a description. And I don't want you to go close and go, oh, is that them? But if you can get a cell phone picture with a plate on it out of the window, we can blow it up and get a license plate. That's a head start. Because, you know, when you tell me it's a white, late model four-door Jeep, you know how many of those are there on Palmdale? And there's also tan ones and light gray ones all over the place. So, you know, then people complain when we stop and pull them over for that. So we have to be careful who we're pulling over these days.
Has any arrest been made in the car theft in Shannon Valley that caused that accident on the freeway?
I don't know. I haven't
Was
heard
it three weeks ago?
CHP handled that. They haven't told us if they've gotten anything.
Oh, would they actually do the arresting if it's a, then? I mean,
well, if they catch the guy, if it starts on the freeway and ends up on the street.
No, but I mean, the guy took off, so has he been arrested in his car?
Oh.
He's supposedly down Long Beach.
No, we haven't heard.
I haven't heard.
It was my car stolen.
Oh, was it?
It wasn't mine, but it's my
car. Oh, I have not heard anything on...
No,
but LAPD has contacted us because they have part of our, they have something in my husband's, was in the car.
Oh.
So, yes, we haven't, he's called them, but they haven't called him back, so.
Okay.
So. Okay.
Thank you.
Other than that, let's see what's coming up. Halloween's coming up. Just mm-hmm. your young ones, be careful. Mm-hmm. Go to the events that are planned. It's safer. And I think that's, no, we're having our big chili cook-off on October 15th, Saturday at the Wayside. And that's going to be for our 999 for Kid, which is our kids' foundation. And we're raising money for that and our other biggest charity, Special Olympics.
October when is your chili cook-off?
The 15th. And then?
What time?
It runs 10 to 4.
And where did you say?
The jail facility. It's going to be at the Equestrian Center, which is off of Parker Road, where the animal control at Wayside.
Oh, up in Alabama.
In Castaic, yeah.
Oh, in Castaic.
The other valley. Yeah.
Not Burbank, okay.
Yeah, and then let's see. And the 20th, Thursday, that is our tip-a-cop. This I have to plug in. Many people don't know that Special Olympics is law enforcement's biggest charity throughout the world. Mm-hmm. So we act as hostesses or waiters, waitresses, whatever you would like to call us. It's going to be at Red Robin at the mall. Mm-hmm. And any of the tips we get all go to Special Olympics. Mm-hmm. So you'll see me out there serving drinks and salads. October 20th.
All day?
It starts, I think, at 2. Mm-hmm. I think it goes 2 to close.
Oh, late night.
Well,
very cool.
We do it every year.
Is that AV Mall? So,
yeah.
What's that?
AV Mall?
Yeah, AV Mall. Mm-hmm. And Red Rock, yeah. So.
Red Robin Restaurant.
I'll be there. I'll go.
All right, now have all the rest of the stats for next week.
Not going to give a tip, though.
And then it's, you know, you just order me around, go, more water. More water. I'm good for it.
That's awesome.
Oh, and then for anybody who missed the steam train coming through town, it was quite spectacular.
I heard it.
Really?
Yeah.
I got a call a half hour before it came through from a rail fan out here. Goes, hey, you know, there's a steam train coming through town?
Yeah.
No, a steam train? Like, what? Or a fake? No, a real steam train.
I heard it.
It was a, if anybody's familiar with trains, it's a, what they call a 484 Northern, which is a rather large 86-inch driving wheel, built 1921, rebuilt 1940. It's operated by Atchison, Topeka and the Santa Fe Railroad. It will do 103 miles an hour.
Wow.
And when I was sitting at Aliso Canyon at 1010 on the night before, trying to take a picture going, ooh, this ought to be cool because it's probably going to be going real slow. I think it was doing 60 when it went through the intersection. I could hear it coming all the way through Soledad. And you could hear the poof, poof, poof. And then you hear the whistle, and then I'm going, okay. There it went. So they used it to dedicate the private dedication ceremony for the new Acton Metrolink. Because they didn't invite the public to this.
No.
It was only some dignitaries, and it was like, okay, but...
We should have been invited.
Well,
yeah.
One of your members was there. Angela was there.
Yeah.
So, Angela Long made it start.
Because they gave, some of us got to at least get tours of the cab and the engine and sit in the engineer's seat.
That's cool. I can hear it go by.
It was also in the middle of the...
And then they towed it backwards all the way to Union Station when they were done.
Wow. It was not there.
Because there's no place to turn a steam engine around up here anymore. So they just put it in neutral and towed it back at about 15 miles an hour.
Rolled it back down the hill.
What day was that?
I have a picture.
That was last Wednesday.
I have a picture of it on its southbound journey.
Well, if you want to see it, I got a whole DVD I made for one of our guys with all the pictures I took.
Oh, wow.
That's Michael.
But, yeah, it was quite spectacular to see that thing come in and they did a nice open. They're all dressed in cowboy attire. Then the woman in charge, I go, well, you know, we could have had people out here with horses and cowboy hats. Really, in this area? Yeah, horse ranch, park. That's okay. She's just a PR person for the railroad. But sorry. I offered to put on a white hat and a black mask and pass out silver bullets, but she didn't understand the connection with that, I guess. But anyway, that was a good event. That was at least, for the 20 people that were there for the dedication.
Yeah, well, it wasn't publicized.
Yeah,
it wasn't. No, because
they didn't want them there, I guess.
I guess they didn't want. Yeah, they did. All the dedication was done on the new terminal, and I did find out that if you look, because Angela and I walked it, they have the crossing gate that I told you about. That's for the pedestrians. It's on the east side. They're going to put another one on the west side, I guess. That's future plan. This way people don't have to walk to half a mile down to the end of the terminal and then cross and come back. It's going to be closer. But this will allow them to pull trains off on sidings so they can have, if they have a passenger train come through on each side, they can go north and south or east and west.
And it does not have access from the south.
No, it's all going to be planted with...
Perfect. That's
plants, regional plants from that area, so they have to come and park in the main lot and then cross. So, and it has no facility, that's just the benches with the same type front that's on the other side of the station, so.
Are we talking about Vincent?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's where the steam thing?
That's where it came in, yeah. They pulled it on the siding and then let it sit for...
Someone told me about it, but there was no information about it.
Yeah, I asked if anybody notified. They had...
I had gotten an email, but it was in the middle of my Tuesday, and I couldn't do it.
Not only did they not tell us, because usually if the supervisor's going to be there, we're notified.
Yeah.
They didn't tell us. They didn't tell our Metrolink Sheriff's Department either, because I called them up going, you know anything about a steam train coming through? No. What other stories you got? No, here it is. And if you go to this website, it's being followed by rail fans. Really? And they went out and go, they didn't tell us.
I know.
So it wasn't well publicized, but we're trying. But I heard the Christmas train might be back this year.
Oh, that's awesome.
Nice. Because they asked if they were going to use the steam train to tow it. They said, no, that's because the steam train is BNSF or ATC Santa Fe, and they would have to get permission to bring it back. Mm-hmm. So we tried.
The Christmas train is always a blast. The kids love it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, ladies. All right. Tom has let us know that he had problems. He had to have his truck towed and all kinds of things.
No.
So he's apologizing.
He's okay.
He's apologizing. Just said issues.
Okay. Announcements and correspondences. A couple of things. We have free disposal day, Saturday, October 8th, at Waste Management, 8 a.m. to 2 p.m., Waste Management Lancaster, Lancaster facility on Avenue F. And bring your used tires for our free tire recycling event, Saturday, October 29th what's the drop-off location? It's the Road Yard on Sierra Highway. And I can give you these flyers.
October
29th. From 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. And this is not so much a problem for us here, at least not where I live, but it is certainly in the Antelope Valley. There's free mattress recycling collection event Got an old mattress. There's three dates, October 15th and in East Avenue T, October 22nd, Avenue L. These are all public works yards. And October 29th is East Avenue J. If you have mattresses you need to get rid of, there's that. I have not had a chance to look at the agendas yet for the board, the supervisors, although I scanned through it. I did pull it up electronically just before the meeting, and I scanned for the word Acton, and it didn't appear anywhere, so I assume there's nothing going on. I guess I'll speak for John later. Okay, so that's it. I have what I have for announcements and correspondence.
That's it. Okay, what's next on the agenda?
Okay. Okay, now we go into our topics. I have three topics, potentially four topics to address. Just briefly, the high-speed rail.
Okay.
I went to the...
We're doing high-speed rail first?
Yeah. I went to the public meeting that they held in San Fernando area, mm-hmm. the last one that they held before they released their preferred alternative. Spoke with the sound engineer and was substantially alarmed by a number of the things that I was hearing, and not the least of which is, in Acton, there will only be like 6 trains an hour going through. Well, I know for a fact it's going to be 22 trains an hour, which is one train every 2.4 minutes. And also a number of things that they talked about with their the noise profile. So what I decided to do was, and it's consistent with what we talked about at the last town council meeting about some of the concerns, I spent the last probably 9 days solid going through their noise assessment procedures, analyzing all of the references that they used to cite to justify their noise criteria, because basically the way they've set their analysis method up, the way it's been set up is, if you have one of these trains going by every 2.47 minutes at about an 85 decibel range, which is about a jackhammer going off about 55 feet from you, that is not sufficient to crack their threshold for significant impacts, and there will be no mitigation. And also, when you are on an elevated structure, as they're proposing here at Red Rover, their own standards state that if it's over 1,000 feet long, which this one will be because it's almost half a mile, it will be constructed with slab construction, not ballasted tie. Therefore, it will generate at least 5 decibels more than it would otherwise generate. So it'll be probably about 106 decibels at the 50 feet mark from where the train, from the track. And the sound only dissipates at a rate of about 3 decibels for every distance doubled, which means within 1,000 feet it'll still be well over 85 decibels. It'll still be over 90 decibels, actually. The other concern, and I had this discussion with them and they didn't seem to be worried about it, was that when a train travels at more than 180 miles an hour, its noise profile is quite different from a regular train. You get you get a lot of noise in what they call the low frequency range, which is like drum roll type range, which you actually feel when it goes by. And sound barriers, Federal Railway Administration says straight up sound barriers in these low frequency ranges are not effective. So even if they put sound barriers up, it's not going to attenuate these sounds because it doesn't work. Such a low frequency, it just goes right through. So anyway, I spent the last week and a half basically writing up an analysis of their entire noise analysis approach, impact assessment approach. And I had done this a little bit in detail, in a little bit of detail for scoping comments, but I decided that I needed to fully document in detail all the analyses, elements of their analysis, and show how they're incredibly deficient, particularly because their noise impact criteria are based 100% on urban noise profile studies. And when I analyzed all these documents, all of them state this is for urban facilities and urban impacts. You should not use these when you're considering noise impacts on lower ambient in areas where ambient levels are much lower, like where we are, 50 decibels, 45 decibels, 60 decibels. So at any rate, I've compiled this. I'm going to be submitting it as a letter on my own behalf tomorrow as a citizen. But I have also sent it out to the town council, and if the town, if you guys want to look at it and generate our own letter. Right now is the time, basically the last opportunity we have to have comments to try to affect the EIR. I don't believe that they're going to make any changes to the EIR based on this, but it lays out all of the elements that you would need to make a technical argument in a lawsuit regarding CEQA violations. So basically exhausting all of our administrative remedies in that regard. So that's high speed rail.
Becky? I know at the last high speed rail meeting, you were talking, before the outreach program, we were talking about people were writing letters to try to gain support from some local government and officials, like to support Acton and asking for everything to be on the ground. Well, I was helping John with that Williamson Act thing, and I found a contact at the Department of Conservation. His name is Farrell Grundy, and I passed that on to John. So John's developed this nice relationship with regional planning, Max Thalander, and Farrell Grundy at the Department of Conservation.
Yeah, he sent
me. Well, I sort of came up with an idea that why not appeal to them for some support, because if you go on their website, they're actually working with High Speed Rail up in Central Valley with the farmers up there, trying to preserve some of the farmland that the High Speed Rail is going to be disrupting. They're working with those people trying to preserve, and in the Merced area. So I reached out to them in mid-September with an email to two different email addresses from the Department of Conservation. And to this date, I've gotten no responses. And what I was just asking for is maybe a short letter of support saying that coming through Acton would serve no purpose, to go above ground, below ground, just keep it all underground, not to disrupt our open land and the beauty of our town.
And our agricultural resources.
Exactly. And so because I got no response, all of a sudden I realized, oh my gosh, here we've got this nice relationship going with Farrell Grundy. John's on a first name basis with these guys like every other day on the phone. I even had an email for him today.
Oh, okay.
And I also put in a call to him, but he'd already left the office. So I will let you know if I hear anything back.
That would be great, because we have sort of a template.
Yes, because they are working directly with High Speed Rail Authority.
Yeah.
To help with some of this open land protection. And I'm thinking, okay, so they can kind of be down the middle and say, okay, well, we're helping High Speed Rail, but we also understand that Acton's a beautiful open area that deserves some protection.
Right. So that's a great idea, because we do have a template. You know, if they don't, well, what do you want us to write? Here, say this.
Yeah, well, so if you guys have a template.
Yeah,
if
we
you
do.
Could pass it on to me, and then I can pass it on to Farrell, make their
sure.
job a little easier.
That would be awesome. And it talks about the Aliso Rostre Special Interest Area, talks about the conservancy linkages between Sierra Pelona and National Game, St. Angeles National Forest and Game Monument, which is right where the Red Rover overcrossing will be. So
that would make it a lot easier to actually get a response if we
had. Yeah, exactly. And we've had some success. We've gotten letters from Wilk and from Knight. I haven't checked the town council website for about a week, but as of a week ago, I hadn't heard back from Diane Feinstein's guy. He did reach out to me, and I was trying to set up a meeting with him. So we have, so far as I know, all of our elected officials have stepped in. I don't know about Carol Liu, though. I don't know how Tom was successful with that. Okay, so I think we have enough to give to
David Barrett. Because
we were asking for a letter of support from the Board of Supervisors as well, the same way that they provided one for the folks down in Shadow.
Shadow Hills.
Thank you. Shadow Canyon, wait, no. So
was this a continuation of your conversation here on Saturday with the sound engineer, or you felt like you needed to go down to San Fernando?
Oh,
because I couldn't get anything out of him.
What they were saying was just not true. And then I did more research, and I went down and I took my research. And it was funny because the sound gentleman that was there in San Fernando was not the gentleman who was here.
Oh,
okay.
But that's what I wanted.
But so I brought with me that the noise analysis they did for the, I think it was just Fresno to Bakersfield, Bakersfield section, right? Which is where all this a lot of problems are, right?
Right.
So I said, look, in this entire report, you never report one single noise level that anybody will be experienced to which they will be experienced. Like, what they did is they plotted all these homes, and they just stated, they colored the dot black if there was no significant impact, and white if there was a significant impact. But they never said what the impact was. And the impact depends on what the existing ambient levels are. So it's different for everybody, every area. But they're required of their own reporting guidelines, federal and state guidelines, to provide noise contour maps that state what the sound will be at various areas in the envelope around the track. And the guy said, look, I know that data was there. I said, he goes, I wrote the report for Fresno to Bakersfield. So I said, find it. So he's going through, he goes, it's here, he goes, well, here's this table. I said, that summarizes it. It says the noise levels will be from 70 to 85, and that's not even accurate. That's average over 24 hours. It's not instantaneous noise levels. And he goes, well, it's in here. Literally 2 minutes, I'm just standing there, and he goes, it's right here. And then he goes, oh, they must have taken it out. He put it in the report, but when the agency issued the report, they omitted all of that data. So
this was the engineer that you talked to on Thursday when you were down there that said,
that
I wrote this report, and it's...
Well, he said he wrote the report. He didn't know I had it. I said, well, here. And I gave it to him finally. He kind of was a little surprised to see that, but...
Did we get that off the flash drive that we got from...
No, I had had that from my scoping comments in 2014.
Yeah.
But there's a lot to this letter. It's 19 pages, single spaced.
19 pages, Jackie, that you wrote?
Yes.
Are you going to send that to us?
I already did. About 4 hours ago. So that's why I haven't been on the website or answering phone calls for a long time. At any rate, so I'm going to mail it on my own behalf tomorrow.
Okay.
But if the town council wants to jump in, time to act is going to be within the next 2 weeks. I mean, literally, they're coming out with their preferred alternative by January. Mm-hmm. I think it's going to be more like December. So. Yeah.
I've always said that.
Do you have any petitions going or anything like that?
People? Petitions?
Yeah, against the rail or trying to get it underground or like what we can do as...
For years.
For years we've been doing that.
We've had huge public meetings, hundreds of people. We have an organization dedicated to that. So if you're interested in work helping us, what we need, the next high-speed road meeting, which I don't know, it's scheduled probably the next month or so, what we're going to do is divide people up into sections. You're going to consider noise impacts. You're going to consider land use impacts. You're going to consider biological impacts. And so we need people to read what they've done on other EIRs so that people are ready to hit the ground running when we get our EIR. Because I added up the Fresno to Bakersfield EIR was almost 1,500 pages. And that doesn't count technical appendices, any of the appendices at all, technical reports, which is another couple thousand pages. So normally in CEQA you get 30 days, sometimes 45 days. So I've asked in this letter for 120 days.
Okay, that's good.
Because it's almost five times longer than it's supposed to be. CEQA says these reports aren't supposed to be longer than 300 pages. It was almost 1,500. So if you're interested, at the next meeting that Pam puts together, I think we're going to try to divvy up sections and so you actually will read the section, you'll see what we're going to have, and so you'll know, you'll be prepared for it. One of the other things I really stepped into also was, no matter what the animal, domestic, wild animal, or even domestic wild, like we have the tigers down in Shambhala, they're in a facility, but they're not obviously domestic. Their threshold for any impacts is 100 decibels, averaged over a 1 second period, which means it's not even peak. And according to their calculations, that's not going to happen. That you won't have that level more than 60 feet from the track, according to them. So therefore, there will be no animal impacts at all on this project. Wildlife impacts. Now, their 100 decibel threshold is an interim threshold that FRA recommended almost 10 years ago. And as I pointed out to High Speed Rail in this letter, they have not implemented any studies to actually develop an actual level, impact level, based on types of animals. and they've been implementing this interim level on every single EIR that they've assessed, that they've developed and certified, which is, then it's not interim, they're implementing it with the force and effect of an adopted standard. So, which is another area that we can take them on with. But at any rate, so the way they've looked at animal impacts and not just people impacts, but animal impacts is reprehensible, so.
Crazy.
I asked the environmental engineers at that outreach meeting, I said, well, I live here on Larry Way, and at this point, because you've been above ground and I've lowered, they're just going back underground, and they're gonna be approximately 100 feet under my house and the neighbor's houses.
Yeah.
I said, what might I expect to feel 100 feet of, you know, distance between me and you? And the one fellow answered the question, he goes, well, you might hear the boom when the train enters the tunnel. It's going so fast that it'll create like a boom from the pressure of the air being forced into the tunnel. And I said, so I'm gonna hear a boom every time a train goes by? He goes, well, yeah, that's what you might hear.
On each tunnel, by the way. Each tunnel.
He told me four trains this way in an hour and four trains that way in an hour. So he said about eight trains an hour. I go, great.
No, it's their own plan states during peak, starting at 6 a.m., it'll be, I think it was 11 trains in each direction. And off peak, it'll be 7 trains in each direction. That was my recollection.
They were very vague about everything. I felt like I walked away with no information because they're doing this supposedly to get input from the community, but they're coming to us without a definite plan yet. And hopefully they're going to take our input and then go do their definite plan. But
that's
we
what
were
they
so frustrated by the vagueness of everything. Everything is so generalities. Everything's generalities. Or let me take you over to this person to ask.
Yeah.
This person. I mean, I got escorted all over the room that day.
And when they answer the question, like, "What? Okay, I'm 1,000 feet from this track. What's the noise going to be?" They'll say, "Oh, it's about 69 decibels." Oh, that's not so bad.
Mm-hmm.
But that's on a 24-hour average. So the actual peak sounds you hear 1,000 feet from the train will probably be on the order of 89 decibels, which is more than, like I said, the jackhammer. So, and if it's up on elevated tracks with just the slap instruction on the ballast and tie, it's gonna be even 5 decibels louder. And where we live in Acton, because of the elevation where we live, the temperature that we live, our humidity, there's gonna be very little what they call sound absorption or sound attenuation in the air. And because we have very little green, there's going to be very little ground attenuation.
And the mountains.
And so it's a lot of it's going to be reverberation. And
the horses are going to get really agitated by that.
No, they won't. Because
when they were talking about putting those...
She's being...
100 decibels.
Yeah,
it's not
when they were talking about putting those windmills, you know? What was it, 10, 15 years ago, they wanted to put them on the steerable homes here? And it was a private company, a bunch of private investors wanted to do it. I mean, that would have just driven the horses crazy. That going all night long.
Right, well, and you know, a lot of times horses, they sense things through their jaw. They're very sensitive to vibration.
Mm-hmm.
And here's the key, this is really important for people to understand. Their entire basis for calculating noise and vibration for these trains is entirely theoretical. Because nobody has ever built a steel wheel train that goes 220 miles an hour and measure the sound of the vibration from it. So it's entirely theoretical. They've built maglevs that go that fast, but there's magnetic levitation, so there's no steel wheel, there's no track that they're, you know, contacting. So, you know, everything is theoretical, including what they're gonna do to your house and Uncle Sasa.
Yeah, they're just very vague about everything.
Unfortunately.
We skipped John's report.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay, it doesn't bother me at all.
Go ahead, John.
No problem.
I'm done. Yeah, high school rod, unless anything else.
Well, we need to decide if we want to do something as a town council about this letter. You're going to send the letter as an individual.
Yes. So it's going to be in the record.
It'll be in the record. Okay, I'm just thinking my way through this.
Well, what we can do is we can decide to write a letter and springing from what I prepared, take out what you don't want, keep what you do want. That way we can get it done. Well, I'll approve it through the review process. You can send it out.
It seems to me like we should.
Yeah, this is the last, we have no time left.
Exactly.
So should we do that? Should I make a motion? Is that something? Okay, so I'll make a motion and the town council send the last ditch effort letter to High Speed Rail to get these issues addressed.
The noise issues.
Noise, well, it's also noise and there's a number of things, rates.
Okay.
Did you get all of that?
Okay, ATC to make a last ditch effort letter to get
To get the impacts properly assessed and the train put underground in our community and away from wells.
Can I have a second on that, please?
I second it.
Second by Catherine. Any discussion? Make sure.
No,
I just want to make sure she's got
And
it.
When do we need to send this by?
A month ago.
Yeah, time is of the essence.
Well, I'll write it up and send it out. Well, I've already sent the body of it. I've sent the attachment. No, I haven't written my cover letter. It's only a few paragraphs long, saying, be afraid.
Okay, we've got a second. Any discussion? What do I say next?
All in favor?
All in favor.
Aye. Any opposed?
Motion passed.
Okay.
Is this letter to be published? Should
sure.
Be published? Send me a copy.
I will.
Oh, 19 pages of it.
19 pages signals space.
Well, town council might not want to put all of it in. Whatever they, I got kind of heated in like some areas, but I'm not backing down from it.
You, Jackie, got heated?
My face red can tell. The last
thank you, Jackie, for doing that. Because
sure.
It's, I know you spent a considerable amount of time. And
yeah, I saw it on my account. So
19 pages and 9 days of work.
This is important.
Tremendous.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you.
All right, library report. Sorry, John.
I just have a couple of things.
Wave
I hope
at us.
Very quick. hello, everyone. Welcome to the library. Just a couple of quick things. I know some of you have noticed the chairs in the back. That's part of the charity event, part of our author's luncheon coming up on the 21st of this month. If you're interested in buying tickets for that, please contact Lee Jennings or Kat Candino. They will tell you the price. They'll take your money. It'll work out great for us. We always put on a really good show. I have here November 8th, obviously a big day. I've got the election booklet. It's a very light 220 pages. I have lots of them if you're interested. But I don't have enough for everybody. So if you're interested in taking any, maybe one per family, something like that, if you don't mind, because there aren't a whole lot of these things floating around.
Are you getting those in the mail? You should be.
Well, I think you have to request them now, if I'm not mistaken.
Really?
No, they have to send them out.
Everybody's
supposed to get that in the mail.
Okay, I heard there was a shortage, so I got 3 boxes the other day.
Oh.
It's still not enough for anybody.
I'll take one, definitely.
Yeah,
okay, they're on display about the circulation desk. Just wander in, grab a copy.
Okay, thank you.
Also,
The author's lunch you said was
October the
21st?
22nd.
22nd?
So on last Saturday.
Okay, sorry.
So I was looking at the calendar for next year. The first and the third Monday in January the 2nd and the 16th, are both holidays and the library is going to be closed. And I don't think that's happened in a very long time. It's possible to get somebody here to open the doors, but because they're holidays, I have to put in the paperwork ahead of time.
Okay.
So the sooner the better, if you can tell me what you want to do.
Well, probably not January 1st. I don't know, what day was that? Did you say it was January 1st?
The 2nd and the 16th.
Oh gosh.
Well, whatever you want.
Yeah,
I'll
have
to.
Can we reserve like first and third for the rest of the year, though? Or is it? Are we already in?
So you're already in for the first and third.
Oh,
it's just
okay,
the holidays that are short.
Okay.
All
right.
But
we'll get.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm a little uncomfortable.
The 11th is an option. If you want the 11th, you have the 12th.
Oh, okay.
January 11th. Open.
Okay, maybe. Thank you very much.
Okay, I'll mark it down. And as usual, there are some flyers sitting around on the table over there if you're interested at all. If anything happens with the new dates, I'll send everybody an email.
All right, thank you very much.
I'm sorry, the 9th, January the 9th, 2017, I'm looking at the 2016.
Oh yeah, that's a Monday, great.
Yes, that's all I have for tonight.
Thank you very much.
Sorry, we skipped you there for a while.
My bad.
Do we remember how to lock the door?
Do we remember how to lock the door?
Yeah, because Tom's the one who usually locks the door.
Okay.
So before he leaves.
I know, I was told once upon a time how to do it.
I can show you real quick.
Okay, well, can you show Kelly?
I can do that, yes.
Yeah, she's way more reliable than me.
Why, we can read. Okay, want to move on to your next item, Jackie?
I understand this has, and I did get a chance to call Regional Planning about this today, but my understanding is they're still having the access ordinance meeting here in November on the 5th.
November 5th.
Yeah, exactly, Saturday the 5th.
Yeah.
But at the ERTC meeting, Susan heard that date hadn't been nailed down permanently, so, and I meant to call today, but I got too busy. So as far as I understand, it's still happening. So please come and talk about it, because there's this regulation. It's a new ordinance that affects anybody who pulls a building permit. Even if you want to make a modification to an existing facility, even pulling an electrical permit. You have to show legal access, physical access, and prove that get it certified by an engineer that it meets all fire department standards, which are not stated anywhere, so who knows what they are. There are ways to get waivers, but the waiver process requires certain documentation, including that you file something with the recorder's office that permanently runs with your land that says you have no access and no way to get to your home. So anybody buying your land will see that in the chain of title. Anyway, so please come if you are concerned at all. If you do not live on a county maintained road, it will affect you one way or the other someday, I'm sure.
November 5th was a Saturday, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And do we have the time on that, Jackie?
That's when you answer. I thought I'd written it down, but I didn't.
It's in the journal.
Mm-hmm. It's in the journal.
Okay.
San Gabriel Mountains National Monument comment period was extended to the second week of November, sometime after the end of the first week of November. I'm still participating on the collaborative meeting group to provide comments on behalf of the Association of Rural Town Councils and by extension the Acton Town Council. Their draft plan is only 27 pages long, although the environmental assessment is much longer than that. They still have no, they are not changing the plan to include any standards that protect objects of interest identified in the monument proclamation signed by President Obama, which includes the Aliso Araspe Special Interest Area, which is the first object identified in the proclamation, and it is still. And I went to there's one more scoping meeting tomorrow, or not scoping meeting, a public comment meeting tomorrow. I will be going to it if anyone wants to come with me. It's in Wrightwood to address this concern and this issue. At the last meeting the public meeting that was down in Santa Clarita I went to, I asked specifically how the Forest Service is commenting or providing, is cooperating with the high-speed rail on the configuration of the train through the forest, because as many as you know, the train in the Aliso area transitions from above ground to underground right there at the monument boundary in two places. And of course it will be over 100 decibels in the whole Aliso, and that's in the Aliso Araspe Special Interest Area, the mapped protection area. And when I asked the Forest Service they're a cooperating agency with the Federal Railway Administration, so they're required by law to coordinate with CHISRA, High Speed Rail, and FRA. And I asked how they're implementing the monument requirements, protection provisions, in their analysis of this project because the monument plan is not done yet. And I was told that they are going to make sure that they are looking at the monument plan when they're commenting on the high speed rail project. And I'm like, well, how are you implementing the protective provisions? Well, the plan isn't done yet, so we don't have those nailed down yet. It's very disturbing and very of concern to me. They seem to be unaware. And I asked them, I said, what are you doing with projects that have, that will be approved before your monument is done? And he said, well, what projects are going to be approved? And I said, well, their final EIR is going to be coming out as you're finalizing this plan. This plan will be done by next October, 1 year from basically now. Mm-hmm. The EIR will be out, certainly the draft EIR will be out well in advance of that, and the final EIR might actually be out by then. He seemed unaware of that. So I'm going tomorrow to reiterate that position.
What time is that meeting tomorrow, Jackie?
That is, it's in Wrightwood, and it is, Two, 3:30 to 7:30. So, you want to come with me?
Awesome.
It's not a collaborative meeting, which are closed meetings. This is a public meeting that they're hosting. So, and the last thing I just wanted to point out, Lakes Town Council had a very good day a few weeks ago. Many of you might know this, but the Regional Water Quality Control Board was developing a new standard for Una Lake, Lake Elizabeth, and Lake
Hughes.
Thank you. And I guess it was about a month and a half ago. The plan that they came out with was that all the residents would have to pay to redo their septic, about $20,000 each, redo their waste treatment, and do a number of other things. I got together with Robin, who's on the town council, and I went over the report. And there were a lot of math errors in their tables. And when I pointed that out to Robin and his wife, they took the numbers and they presented it at the hearing, at the water board meeting. Mm-hmm. And apparently it was so disturbing to the board that they were really concerned and not happy with staff that they would have so many math errors in their final plan that was going to cost these people, you know, millions of dollars, literally. So I guess, though, I wasn't there, but I understand from Mr. Grooms of Supervisor Tonovich's office, there was so much going on with these numbers that the board agreed that they approved the project. They agreed that they wouldn't go forward with it until they found the funding to pay for it. And so the residents would not be on the hook to pay for any of the repair. And according to Richard wasn't there either, but he heard from some public works guys because the county was there. That while the board was approving, after they approved it, they were thinking, wait, wouldn't we just agree to? But it's done. So so they will not be affected, at least fiscally speaking, for this, which is, it's a major, it's a
so
huge
who made,
thing.
Who made the errors?
The staff. It was all the staff before.
Public water?
Well, I don't know. I think it's their contractor. I mean, I don't have the report with me, but I went through and, you know, I've written technical reports. It's not hard to make a number of mistakes. And if you go through, you know, that's what you're supposed to QA these things.
Right.
One of the numbers was that, you know, their current level for nitrates was, say, X, and then their target level for nitrates was about 40% higher than what it already was. So Robin said, so are you telling us that we can increase nitrates for, you know, and anyway, it was very obvious. So it's a win for a rural community that was facing certain financial ruin. So that's the last of the reports I have on the issues. So.
AB 1263?
Oh.
People made comments on it.
I hope people did. I know a number of people did. The announcement, it's been put in the Country Journal. I think I also sent it to Acton, Agua Dulce News and the Valley, did I send it to the Valley Press? I think I did. That, you know, Governor Brown has a line item veto authority on the bills he signs. And as far as I know, the bill is still on his desk. Just before the legislature session ended, a sort of a gut and amend process came through, and it was for public water systems, but a line was added that said that no building permits will be issued if a source of water is hauled water or bottled water or retail water, you know, basically sparkless type. And they've equated, for example, hauled water, which is delivered in 4,000 to 6,000 gallon trucks, to people using, you know, sparklets. Obviously, sparklets, you're going to have sanitary concerns, right, in a resident. So, you know, I'm not going to quibble with that, but hauled water is ridiculous. So, at any rate, so that was approved, and it's sitting on the governor's desk, and it's going to be there for another couple of days, unless it's
Jackie, I saw on the internet that he approved it Thursday.
Did he? Okay.
That's my information.
Did he make any changes to it, do you know?
Not the way I see it. I printed out a copy of what I think was the latest one after the changes, and
okay. And that, so that line was still in there?
Yep, about hall water.
Oh, okay.
That was just this last Thursday, so.
So thank you for that. So now the concern is that how is the board going to implement this? The Regional Water Quality Control Board is the ones who will be implementing this legislation.
You can double check me and make sure.
I will.
But I went up on the government site, you know, after Googling the SB, and then went to the latest on the bill, and that's what it said at the government.
Oh, wait, were you on the Senate site? This legislative site?
No, I believe it took me to the
governor's
state
site.
Because I went on this on the governor's site earlier on Thursday, or late Wednesday, or before I went to press, and it hadn't been signed yet, but Larry may have been on it afterwards.
I'll follow up on that. Yeah. I would have hoped
somebody can pull it up now, you can probably find out really easy.
Yeah, I'd bring my tablet with me. Well, that's disappointing. So the concern, here's my concern with it. Depending on how the board decides to construe the term using hauled water as a source of residential water, if that's construed to mean anybody who might rely on it at any time for any reason, and you know anybody who has a well, they realize that if their pipe breaks or their pump dies, they might need to pull a load of hauled water, even if it's just once every 50 years. So if they decide to interpret that language to mean, well, anybody on a well needs to, you know, falls under this umbrella because they might use water as a source, hauled water as a source of their drinking water, I'll look into it, and we need to reach out to regional or to water quality control boards and try to participate in their rulemaking. Because now they'll make rules to implement the legislation that was adopted, the statute, you know, statute that was adopted by the legislature.
So I tried to look at, I'm not connected. We won't connect to the library.
Well, I'll check. Probably not tonight. I don't want bad news anymore.
What is it? SB
1263. Yeah, that was signed, the version signed. So. And if it's not been, then, you know, a lot of people need to comment. You know, he can do it. You can, anyway.
Well, I wrote in and asked for a response, but I haven't gotten any response.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't think they will respond to it. But
there's a place to check off. Do you want a response?
Oh, really?
I checked it off.
Me too.
But there's been nothing. No word. And this was, what, a week or a week and a half ago?
Okay. Well, I think all of that is in the Country Journal, you know, recommendation on things to say. You can have 6,000 characters. What I pointed out was residences that rely on hauled water are the most water efficient residences there are.
Mm-hmm.
They use 75% less water than not hauled water people. And I even said, if everybody in the state of California lived on hauled water, you wouldn't have a drought.
That's very interesting.
It's true. No, that number's solid. Don Henry backed it up with facts and figures in our comments on the hauled water ordinance. So.
Oh, I just want to let you know when you're ready to move on to the next subject.
I think we're done, yeah.
Because John's not here tonight, but John and I have been kind of corresponding regarding the outreach articles and stuff, and he's been researching the heck out of that Williamson Act.
Yes.
Yeah.
But he's amazing.
Do you want to read what he's emailed us?
Is that the one he sent to Tom?
Yes.
Yeah, because I got that too.
And you wanted to share it with everybody? That would be great.
Good.
Because I, you know, as far as I'm concerned, you're on the committee with him working on this.
Oh, I got that contact for Earl Rundy.
Because he didn't see that website.
I did.
Well, it started Tom and Pam and to me, so
yeah.
My okay. website, so.
So this is what John Farrar, who's not here tonight, wrote to Tom and the other council members, but he's doing an outreach article to the community, just things of interest. And I had stumbled across this thing on the Conservation Department's website called the Williamson Act. And what it is it was just very briefly, it kind of evolved around the post-World War II era. And it's a way for California to help people that have large parcels of land. Initially, it was intended to be 100 plus acres. But if you qualified, it was agricultural land or grazing land, or even now they're even just looking at open land, just for the scenic beauty of it. But prime land is considered land that is irrigated. So Acton wouldn't necessarily have a lot of prime land, but we certainly would have some qualifying properties. I also learned, because of John's efforts, that all the information that was on the conservation website has now expanded.
Oh,
there's
wow.
a lot more stuff there.
Excellent.
And I know it's because John's been digging and Farrell Rundy went, maybe we better put some more stuff out there because people are interested in the Williamson Act. It's kind of a sleepy little thing that, like Catalina Island is almost all protected under the Conservation Act, the Williamson Act. There's a lot of things up in the Central Valley and up in Northern California, but LA County itself doesn't really have anything in the Williamson Act hold yet. But because John has been calling the assessor's office and, you know, the planning commission, he's been calling everybody and their mother, and he's got a great relationship going with Max Thalander, and also this Farrell Rundy, who is the representative with the Conservation Department.
No, Max is with Regional Planning.
Regional Planning, I'm sorry. Yes.
No, that's fine. No, yeah. The reason I ask is it, can we get some Williamson findings here? And
yes.
How long will it take?
Yes, because in all this new information that's now popped up on their website, I was reading it tonight, you don't necessarily have to have 100 plus acres. It's county, the counties, the specific county that it's in can be very creative with it. And you can have contiguous parcels. Let's say you've got four neighbors that their parcels all touch, and they all have open land and they want to keep it that way. They can enter into a contract with this Conservation Department for the Williamson Act and be protected, and it lowers your property taxes way down below what Prop 13 could ever do for you. It's way more, you know, significant. What you do is you're pledging to not develop your land. You're going to leave it natural or pasture or agriculture, whatever it's being used as now. You pledge to leave it that way for 10 years. If you need to opt out, you can opt out, but you go through a 9-year withdrawal process, and every year they will up your property taxes until after the 9 years has passed. You're up to what you would have been had you never been in the program. So, there is a way out of it once you get into it, but it is a 10-year contract, and it's automatically renewable. You don't have to opt back in after 10 years. It just automatically renews. But it's a great tool for people that have large parcels. But John has just been incredible.
Ruth, isn't there a 5-acre minimum for that?
Well, no, there's a 100-acre. It's supposed to be 100 plus acres, which I thought would just deal us right out. But it's county specific. And LA County, I'll read it through what he said. Faster.
She turned this on, not me.
I don't know how. I didn't. This is what John Farrar, our councilman, wrote to Tom. He wasn't able to be here tonight. He's at Cal State San Bernardino. But he wants to summarize what he's found out. Last week, Max Thalander from Regional Planning and I had another lengthy telephone conversation. He informed me he has done considerably more research into the Williamson Act and Los Angeles County's involvement to date. He said his information is still incomplete at this point, but he is gathering more data. However, he did inform me that he has been able to confirm there is currently nothing in Los Angeles County regarding the Williamson Act structured anywhere near the extent of what exists in either San Bernardino or Ventura counties. John had actually sent him what is
registered Williamson Act land in those other counties. So, I mean, John's been a great source of information for the county themselves. So, in other words, county's eyes are open, and they're like, whoa, we've really kind of dropped the ball on this in our county. So,
did they have any idea how long it would take for the county to do something?
You know, I don't know, but I'll continue to read this.
Okay, sorry.
Incidentally, just as a side note, Acton is of particular interest to Max in that he grew up in very close proximity to Acton, Massachusetts. Max is very interested in pursuing implementing the Williamson Act in our general area.
Wow.
He has been in contact with Farrell Grundy from the Department of Conservation in Sacramento. However, Max feels that he should hold off on actually approaching the Board of Supervisors, so it's going to go all the way to the Board of Supervisors, until after the election time, but that we should begin laying the groundwork now. Farrell Grundy has already expressed his interest in assisting, and Farrell, Max, and I will be holding a conference call sometime next week to discuss this further. Also, Max told me last week that he is currently working on the drive-through issue in the Community Standards District revision. He said he would very much like to meet with both the Acton and Agua Dulce Town Councils on both the drive-through topic as well as the Williamson Act. He thought perhaps this would be appropriate for a joint meeting of both councils with, of course, advanced publicity to our region's residents. As you already know, this discussion and review of the Williamson Act began with my request for an article on the Act. In reaching to try to obtain necessary information, it became more and more apparent that the Act apparently had not been put in place in Los Angeles County. That is how we have arrived at this point with considerable communications with George Welch, who is the chief appraiser at the county's assessment office, Max Baylander, and Farrell Grundy, among others. Max and I, this is John speaking, Max and I both feel it would be premature and not particularly helpful to release publicity about the Williamson Act until we may be ready to approach the Board of Supervisors. Having said that, we do need to be putting out some articles in our fledgling series. You suggested you and I get together to discuss this and perhaps plan out other ideas for content. Anyway, he's sorry he couldn't attend tonight, but I think the fact that he and Max Daylander are having a little thing, and Farrell Grundy, and I'm kind of piggybacking on Farrell Grundy to try to get some support for the Heisman grant.
Well, okay, so because that's why I'm asking this, and if we can crank on this fast, we should put this in our Heisman grant letter, because one of the, how big is Long Ranch, Elizabeth? How many acres is it?
150.
Okay, so we meet the threshold, right?
Right.
Ruth, the threshold for Williamson was what? How big?
It was 100.
Okay.
100 plus acres, but it's up to the particular county's discretion. And they could actually, if it was a smaller parcel, especially because she irrigates, she would totally be qualifying prime land.
Well, the reason I point this out is because one of the lawsuits in the Hanford area on the Fresno Bakersfield segment, one of them cites violations of the Williamson Act itself as a cause of action. So what if we have properties that are eligible, whether or not they actually are identified as, because I don't know if you would want that, and I certainly wouldn't push anything that you wouldn't want, but if it's an area that actually is eligible for Williamson Act, they have to consider it, especially if the county is looking at adopting